Hey everyone, I am so glad to be back. I feel like I could jump through the ceiling right now. I have really missed getting to be with you, but also just getting to preach on Sundays. So grateful for the elders preaching over the course of the summer. What a gift it was to sit under their preaching for me personally, and I'm sure for you as well. And so I'm just really glad to be back. I feel like they're gonna tell me I'm talking too loud or something, but I am really glad to be able to speak to you again today. And when we think about what's coming up, there are some really kind of important things that are happening in the life of our church, and I want to share some of them with you. In August, we will continue our digital services through the month of August, and I know that's disappointing for us. It's disappointing for me, but as we just looked at August and we looked towards the fall, we felt like this was the wise course of action. Over the course of August, we will be rolling out some fall plans, September through November. And those fall plans will involve some unconventional uses of Sunday morning. So I just want to prepare you for that. The elders have been praying. I've been praying for the last few weeks, and we feel like the Lord has put a vision on our heart for how to use September through November to be a season of rest and blessing for the people of Mosaic Church. And that's our heartbeat as we head towards those months. And we hope that one of the things that those months will involve are limited in-person services when we can have them. And so we are so grateful that you continue to make space to worship with us on Sunday mornings. And I want to tell you, we continue to worship as a church family on Sunday mornings, even if we're worshiping in our homes, we're meeting with our GCs, or we're getting together with another family, or if it's just us listening as we go for a walk around the neighborhood. Those are all faithful ways for us to continue to gather in this strange and distant time. And so in August, starting next week, August 2nd and 9th, I'll be preaching a two-part sermon called Unafraid and Undivided, which is really my heart for what it means for us to be citizens of the kingdom of heaven and citizens of America in an election year. And so I'll be talking on August 2nd and August 9th about a vision for what it can mean for us to live as a family unified in Christ, though diverse in how we think about the political life in America and what the Bible, particularly Philippians 2, has to say to us about that. And then halfway through August, I'll begin a series that will stretch through the course of the fall, which will be entitled Come Back Stronger, which is just really my heartbeat and vision for how the Lord could be inviting us, even in the midst of a pandemic, to enter into a season of rest so that he can restore us and teach us once again how to attend to his presence in a world of distraction, noise, and speed. And so we'll talk more about that in the days ahead. But the best thing, the thing that I'm most excited to tell you about and that you absolutely cannot miss is this: Kindling Conference. Kindling is an incredible opportunity for you right before a semester of incredibly uncertain waters kicks off for you to set aside some focused time as a family, as parents, as couples, as a single, to think through some really significant issues for your formation and the formation of your households this fall. And so we have incredible speakers lined up. If I just started listing off people, the list is too long, but I'll hit some highlights. We got Jen Wilson and Jeff Wilkin, her husband, speaking to parents about what it means to be stronger as a family in God's presence. And that's going to be on Wednesday night, August 12th. On the Thursday night, the night after, BJ Thompson from Build a Better Us is going to be talking to married couples and just addressing what does a healthy marriage look like. Elizabeth Woodson, a friend and sister in Christ, is going to be talking to singles about what it means to be strong in the Lord. And then on Saturday morning, there are going to be breakout sessions. What healthy sexuality looks like in your marriage, how to talk to your kids about race, how to really learn to live in the presence of the Lord, what it looks like to have healthy body image, what it means to be a confident and Christ-like man. Listen, we wanted to set aside some time because we know the fall holds a bunch of question marks, and we wanted to lay up some kindling. You know how when you're building a fire, you don't just start with the big logs. You lay up some brush, some leaves, some twigs, and you light that. And we, in this Kindling Conference, are really attempting to just lay down some brush, and we're going to pray that God would light a spark and do something with it. And so we hope you'll join us. It's Wednesday night, August 12th for parents, August 13th. There are two sessions, one for singles, one for married couples. And then on Saturday morning, there are breakout sessions. You can go to mosaicrichardson.com/kindling, and you could sign up to come to that, and we would love for you to be there. And so that's all my announcements. I'm going to pray for us, and then you'll hear a scripture reading as we dive into the service today. I am glad to be worshiping with you today, even though I can't see you and I long to. I'm glad that we get to worship as a family in this way. Let me pray for us. Father, we love you. Please focus the attention of our hearts and minds on your Son, Jesus Christ, by the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Christ, amen.
Creatures of our God and King, lift up your voice and with us sing. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Thou burning sun with golden beam, thou silver moon with softer gleam, oh praise Him, oh praise Him, hallelujah, hallelujah, their Creator bless, and worship Him in humbleness. Oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Praise, praise the Father, praise the Son, and praise the Spirit, three in one. His great love, oh praise Him, hallelujah. Christ has defeated every sin. Cast all your burdens now on Him, oh praise Him, oh. Return in power to reign. Heaven and earth will join to say, oh, praise Him. Hallelujah. Then who shall fall on bended knee? All creatures of our God in King, oh praise Him, oh praise Him, hallelujah, hallelujah, oh praise Him, oh praise Him.
Hey everyone, I am so glad to be back with you for another virtual worship service here for Mosaic Church. And we're going to be in Psalm 100 today as we conclude our summer series, Anatomy of the Soul. This summer, we've been privileged to be able to sit under the preaching of other pastors at Mosaic Church, and that's been an incredible joy for me, just as a member of Mosaic Church, to be able to hear from other shepherds here in the life of our church. I'm so tremendously grateful for elders, pastors at this church who want to shepherd God's people, not just in care and behind the scenes, but in the preaching and teaching of God's Word. What a tremendous gift and blessing it is. And a good reminder to us that the authority and power of this church is rooted in the Holy Spirit and the Word of God and not in the personality of any one man. And we are tremendously grateful for the pastors here. I know that I am, and I hope that you are as well, and thankful for their faithful work over this summer in preaching through the Psalms. And that's what we've been doing. We've been diving into the Psalms for this reason, to learn how to bring our emotions into the presence of God. We've talked about grief, anger, hope, longing, frustration, and we have talked about these things because the Bible has something to say about them. John Calvin called the Psalms an anatomy of all parts of the soul. That's where we got the title for the series at, an anatomy of the soul. What he was saying was that when we dig into the Psalms, we find permission to bring however we feel into the presence of God. In the Psalms, we find out that the way that we feel can be brought into God's presence so that he can reorient it and reshape it, and in reshaping it, reform us. And that's a tremendous gift that the psalmist gives us, a template for how we can bring our emotions into God's presence and learn. And today, we wrap up this series with Psalm 100. It's a psalm that emphasizes joy, gladness, singing, thanksgiving, praise, blessing. And I don't know if your life is like mine, but there has been too little of rejoicing in these last strange and dark months. Blessing and rejoicing and praise has been something that has felt far from my heart and far from my lips. And maybe you have felt the same way. We have lamented as a church body. We have prayed together. But today we lean into something that is equally vital, equally countercultural, equally prophetic, and equally necessary. We rejoice and we praise. Now, does the psalmist exhort and encourage us to praise because everything is good? Does he tell us that the source of his joy is pleasant days or a carefree attitude? That I don't think that's what we find in Psalm 100. And so as we read it, what I think that we'll see is this, that when you belong to God, you have reason to bless his name in any circumstance. When you belong to God, you have reason to bless his name in any circumstance. And so I'm going to read Psalm 100. And then afterwards, I'm going to say, this is the word of the Lord. And it's an invitation for you to give thanks and to say, thanks be to God that he has not left his people in silence. He has spoken. This is Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. And what I want us to see here is that when you belong to God, you can bless him no matter the circumstance, because that's what the psalmist is telling us. But I feel that sometimes it's hard to catch the vibe of the psalmist, okay? Sometimes the psalms, you know, psalms are poetry. You kind of have to vibe out to the psalms every once in a while. And I'll tell you, I have found it helpful to read the psalms, not just from the Bible that I typically use, this translation, but from the Message as well, because I think oftentimes it can kind of capture some of the harmony of the psalmist. And so I'm going to read from the Message translation. I'm going to read the psalm again because I think it captures a bit of the cadence and the beat and the rhythm. This is what the Message says in Psalm 100. On your feet now, applaud God. Bring a gift of laughter. Sing yourselves into his presence. Know this, God is God and He is God. He made us, we didn't make Him. We're His people, His well-tended sheep. Enter with the password, thank you. Make yourselves at home, talking praise. Thank Him, worship Him, for God is sheer beauty, all generous in love, loyal, always and forever. Here's what we find in Psalm 100. We find two calls to praise rooted in two promises. We find two calls to praise God rooted in two promises about God. Let's look at the first call to praise in verses 1 and 2. The psalmist says, make a joyful noise to the Lord. All the earth serve the Lord with gladness. The psalmist is saying, listen, there is an invitation for you to praise God, for you to magnify His name, to make a joyful noise, as the Message translation says, to applaud God, to celebrate who God is. This is royal imagery here. This is imagery of magnifying God the King, our King, of looking at Him in the sheer display of His power and saying, this is the true God. And that's what celebrating God begins with, an acknowledgement of who He is. Because if we are going to learn to bless God no matter our circumstance, then we will have to root ourselves in this great truth that God is forever faithful and unchanging, even when the circumstances of the world are constantly changing. And you and I, we need this truth right now because we have been swimming in seas of uncertainty and some of us feel like we're drowning. And what will not be a stable anchor for us is the plans of a school district, the plans of a governor, the plans of the federal government. Those will not be stable anchors for us. What is the Christian's sure and steady anchor is this: God is God. He is worthy of our praise. We celebrate His unchanging character. We make a joyful noise to the Lord. It says, serve the Lord with gladness. This is helping us see that worship, praising God, is an act of service. It's why we call our gatherings worship services. Because when we worship and praise God, it is an act of serving God, of submitting our life to Him and saying, who I am and all that I am belong to You. I love that it says, come into His presence with singing. The Message says it, sing yourselves into His presence. And I like the dynamic here because what the psalmist is getting at is this. Sometimes we have to begin celebrating and praising God to really want to enter into His presence. I was talking with somebody a couple of weeks ago and they just said, hey, it's been hard. It's been hard on Sundays to enter in and worship when we're separated and scattered. And I get that. And they just confessed. They said, you know, it's been real challenging because I just don't want to. I feel bored. I feel weary. I feel detached. It feels like a chore. And what I encourage them to do is this. Start doing it again. Start doing it again. Worship, praise, maybe the day before, set aside some time and just spend with the Lord and say, God, would You prepare me to enter into worship tomorrow morning? Would You prepare my heart to worship with my family on Sunday morning? Because worship often takes preparation. We often sing ourselves and are having to sing ourselves into the presence of God so that our hearts are prepared to enter in and to behold His glory. And this hope, this joy of praising and entering into God's presence, it is the greatest promise of the Christian life. To come into His presence with singing is the greatest joy that you can experience, because here's what Kyle Porter reminded us a few weeks ago in Psalm 42. God's presence is His greatest promise. God's presence is His greatest promise. Trust me on that. There is no greater joy in the world than enjoying the presence of God. And corporate worship, and even worship as we're scattered abroad in our homes, it's a way of priming the pump for us to attend and enjoy and be marked by the very presence of God. And you know, the psalmist is calling us to celebrate who God is and what He has done. And he's doing that by using a very specific word for the word that we read Lord here. That word Lord, when it's in all caps, the Hebrew word that stands behind it is Yahweh. See, the psalmist isn't just talking about a vague idea of God. He is talking about the Lord Yahweh. This is the covenant-keeping God of Israel, the God who is faithful forevermore to all of his promises, even in the midst of a faithless and hostile world. The psalmist is saying, come in, look to Yahweh. Worship Yahweh. He goes on in verse 5 in this second call to praise, in verse 4, it says, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. The message is make yourself at home talking praise. I love that, that there's this invitation for us to make our home with God, and having made our home with God, to talk praise, to celebrate that which is true about God, to give thanks to him for the way that he has blessed and blesses us. So what does it mean to be a people who are giving thanks, who are rejoicing, who are singing in God's presence and making a joyful noise? It means that we live lives of praise. It means that we are people whose lips and mouths are full of rejoicing and thanksgiving. And that begs the question, how do we live this way when we are scattered, when we are tired, and when the days are dark? How do we live rejoicing and praising when we are scattered, when the days are dark, and when we are weary? How do we do that? What would it mean for us to be a people who, when we are tired, are talking praise? When we are scattered, are talking praise? When the days of our world are dark, are talking praise? It would mean that our speech is seasoned with thanksgiving, with praise, that we replace complaining with celebration. We replace trashing with thanksgiving. We replace grumbling with glorifying. This is what it would mean for us to take the patterns of speech that come so easy to us, complaining, gossip, grumbling, trashing, demeaning, self-exaltation, and that we would replace them with a pattern of praising God, giving thanks to God, honoring one another. This is what would mark a people like that, a people who are rejoicing. And I know that for some, it will feel like, well, there's a bigger question. Why would I do this? Why would we do this? Why would we celebrate God in the midst of a pandemic? Why would we celebrate God in the midst of such exhausting and dark days? What reason do we have? And the psalmist gives us that, because these two calls to praise are rooted in two incredible promises. In verse 3, this is what the psalmist says. He says, know that the Lord, he is God. He is God. And what? It is he who made us, and we are his. Now, let me tell you, there is no greater hope in this world than to believe that God has made you his own. Raymond Carver, in a poem, he says, what did I want from this world but to be called beloved? To be called beloved, for us to belong to us, for us to belong to God, for us to belong to the God who has created the world and who has called us to be his own. You see, the call to praise is not rooted in the circumstances around us. It's rooted in the covenant-keeping character of God, God who has created the whole world, God who has made us his own, and God who will keep his people forever. You see, the Lord God, he is in control of the world. This is Yahweh, not just Yahweh who makes covenant with his people. This is Yahweh who created the heavens and the earth, the sea and the land and the world and all those who dwell therein. Like Brian reminded us in Psalm 29, this is the God who sits enthroned over the flood. Like Jeff reminded us last week, this is the God for whom when we fear him, it drives out all other fears. You see, we can rejoice because God has made us his and we belong to him, and nothing can change that. Do you want foundation for radical risk-taking in your life? Do you want a kind of boldness that is only could only be described as heavenly? That kind of boldness, that kind of risk-taking, that kind of courage and confidence and hope is rooted in no place else other than in belonging to God and attending to his presence. And this is what the psalmist is saying. When we enter in on Sunday mornings to worship together, even in scattered dark days where our hearts are weary, do you know what God reminds us about? He whispers to us in the songs and in his word, I have created the whole world. I am remaking the whole world, and you belong to me. That is the sure foundation that we need, not just to live, but to live rejoicing lives, talking praise, having made our home with God in the world. The psalmist says, we are his people and we are the sheep of his pasture. This reminds me of when Pastor Ryan was preaching through Psalm 23, talking about how this good shepherd will guide us through the dark valleys, that he will provide for us. And the psalmist goes on in verse 5 saying that this one whom we belong to, this Lord, is good. Doesn't it feel like we need more direction for good and for goodness? Does it feel to you like the world is populated with an abundance of imitators of goodness? It doesn't. It doesn't. But the Lord is good. He's worthy of our trust. That's what we say at Mosaic, that God is good. He is worthy of our trust. Because he is good, we can trust him and all that he does. And he's good. And guess what? His steadfast love endures forever. We want a love that lasts, right? I almost just, in my head, you know what I heard? I want to know when love is. Okay, now somebody's going to clip that, and that's going to live forever. But that's what I was hearing in my head, and I wanted to be honest with you about it. But the steadfast love of God endures forever, okay? It's not make-believe. It's not fictional. It is firm and certain, okay? And it's not flippant. It's not soft. This is a love that is gentle and kind, and it is steady. And this steadfast love is tied into the covenant-keeping character of this Lord, Yahweh. He does not abandon his promises. The name Yahweh means, I am that I am. This God is steadfast. He's good. His love endures forever. And lastly, he's faithful. He's faithful to all generations. And let me just say something about this right now in this week. If you are a parent of a child, particularly in elementary school, do you know what you're questioning? Maybe your sanity. But on top of your sanity, you know what you're questioning? Oh man, it seems like they're pushing school back. I don't know what they're going to do. And let me tell you something. I get it. I get it that in the midst of uncertainty, it feels like the goal line keeps moving. Here is God's promise to his people. God is going to be faithful to all generations. Do you know who loves and cares about your children? God. Do you know who's going to purpose all things together for the good of his people and to the next generation and the next? God. God is in control. It's his world. As his people, we belong to him. And we are called and invited to enter into his presence and be reminded that in the midst of uncertain waters and uncertain days, in days where it seems wearying and dark and strange and unpredictable, that we can root ourselves in rejoicing because God is God and we are not. And that is good because we belong to him and he has created the world and he is remaking the world. You see, let me tell you, we can live rejoicing as his people, even while we are scattered abroad. We can praise him in our homes alone. We can praise him with our families in our cars. Why? Because when we are together, when we are apart, even when those things are true, God is unchanging. And his presence isn't constrained to a building, a place, or time. He has invited us to make our home with him and to talk praise. Because God is in control, the world is his, even the broken parts, and his goodness, his steadfast love, and his faithfulness is going to go further and deeper than the darkness of a broken world. So let me end here with an encouragement, an exhortation, and an explanation. Let me start with the encouragement to the weary, to the tired. I know that weariness. I know the tiredness. And let me remind you, if you are weary and tired, you belong to God. You are His. Rejoice in God. It will strengthen your heart. It will remind you that He is good and that He loves you and that His presence is satisfying. Maybe take a moment today to write out ways that God has blessed you. Give thanks. Pause the sermon right now and say, God, I am tired, but You are good and have done good, and let me tell You how You have. If you are weary, you belong to God, and He invites you to be refreshed and renewed as you rejoice and praise Him. For the apathetic, spiritual apathy, it sets in most quickly when we are most tired. And there's a lot of tiredness. And you might find some apathy in your hearts. It is easier to distract and detach, to fill our life with distractions and indulgence than to do the hard work of leaning into the presence of the Lord. But let me tell you, if you have found yourself apathetic or detached, you belong to God. And He is not saying that you have to pay back a debt to enter back into His presence rejoicing. He's inviting you to rejoice with the loudest voice. Do you know why? Because God doesn't require a pound of flesh from you to enter back into His presence, because in Christ Jesus He has removed all the shame and all the separation. So enter back in rejoicing and praising. And as you do that, do you know what's going to happen? The Lord is going to begin to rekindle by the power of the Holy Spirit godly affections for you to draw near to God so that He will draw near to you. I know it's easy for us, particularly in a time of transition, particularly in difficult times, particularly when we are tired, to just check out and close down. Fight the temptation. As James said, draw near to God and He will draw near to you. And as He does so, you will be renewed with joy and with spiritual fervor and desire, because as you enter into His presence, you will say like the psalmist, better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. And an explanation. Over the month of August, we're going to begin to talk about what's happening in the fall. I mentioned it in the announcements, and let me tell you, our fall plans are going to be a little bit unconventional. They're a little bit different, but here's the heartbeat behind them. This fall, as we go into September and October and November, we want to slow down so that we can relearn how to just be in the presence of God. We want to slow down so that we can just relearn together what it means to just be, to live in God's presence, to be marked by His presence. You're going to hear us talk about rest, and you're going to see us give you opportunities to practice it. You're going to hear us talk about meditation on Scripture and prayer, and then you're going to see us give you opportunities to practice it. You're going to hear us talk about sharing the story, magnifying God's name, and then you're going to see us give you opportunities to practice it. The reason that we're doing so is because God is inviting us into something. He's providing the space for us, and He can't force you to enter in, and we can't force you. We can only invite you. And let me tell you, people of Mosaic, I love you with my whole heart. I love you, and our time apart has given me space to pray for you like never before. And I have prayed, and I have prayed, and I have prayed. And in those prayers, I have felt the whisper of the Lord inviting us in. Inviting us into a wilderness, to a withdrawal, so that we can quiet our hearts before Him and learn once again what it means to enter into His courts with thanksgiving, to come into His presence with praise, what it means to know, seek, savor, share His goodness, to attend to His presence and be marked by it. I hope that you'll walk with me as we go. We pray. Father, we love You. We pray, God, that You would bless us, that we have heard from Your word. We pray, Holy Spirit, use Your word to produce fruit in our lives. Give us hearts that replace complaining with celebration, grumbling with glorifying, hate with words of honor, that we would be a people marked by praise and rejoicing. Not a naivety to the brokenness of the world, but a confidence that we can celebrate you even in the midst of brokenness because you are good, because your steadfast love endures forever, and because you are faithful to all generations. We pray these things in the name of Christ and by the power of the Spirit. Amen.
Every blessing to my heart to sing thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious song sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, Mount of thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I by thy good pleasure, safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. To grace, how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Use my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above. Oh, that day when, freed from sinning, I shall see thy lovely face, full array. Blood-washed linen, how I'll sing thy sovereign grace. Come, my Lord, no longer tarry. Bring thy promises to pass. Hold me close like gold, refine me till I'm home with thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for thy courts above.
I'm so glad that we got to worship together today. And I'm glad to be able to invite you to receive the benediction as we end our service. This is a way that we practice rejoicing, even in the weird, strange, dark, and tiring days, reminding ourselves that these things are true about God. God, you are better than the best we can find outside of you. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Father, on the hardest days, we know that you are good. We believe. Help our unbelief. Christ Jesus, as we look to you, fill our hearts with joy in your presence. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Walk in the Spirit, brothers and sisters, for where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Read with me. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Bless you. You are sent out in the name of the Lord.